everyone. It's Anne, and welcome to my podcast. Today, I'm going to do a combined version. So this will be some information about Willy Wonka fibers and knitting, as well as my stitching, and then some info on books and spinning, some sewing, a little bit of everything. Thank you all for responding to my last FlossTube video. The overwhelming choice was everybody wanted to have the videos combined since they were watching both of them anyway. So if you are here for the knitting, know that I'm going to start with that, and I'm going to put timestamps in for each of the sections so that hopefully if you're just here for one part or just here for another part, you can just pop to the part that interests you or parts that interest you, and that will be a little bit more efficient for me to only have to haul all my crap out and record once. I am going to try to do like every 2 weeks or so, depending on just life and scheduling and all that good stuff. So let's see, today is Friday, May 11th, 2018. If you are a new viewer, thank you for taking the time to check me out. If you are a returning viewer, as always, thank you for choosing to spend some time with me and listen to me ramble on about various and sundry things that interest me. You can find me on the web. I am at www.woollywonkafiber.com if you're interested in the shop. I'm Woolly Wonka Fibers as well as Little Bird Stitcher on Instagram. I have my shop and knitting stuff at the business, and I have my personal stitching stuff at the other Instagram account, also on Facebook, Woolly Wonka Fibers, as well as the Full Coverage Stitching Group, Full Coverage Fanatics. I think that's all the housekeeping. I hope everybody's doing great. Let's see, life update from this end. It has officially turned summer. If you have watched me or know me in person, the summer and I are not friends. I don't like the hot weather. I know everybody gets all excited and they're outside and everybody's like, woohoo, it's the warm weather. And I'm like full on vampire mode at this point. I try to get up really early, and 70 degrees is too warm for me. If I'm out for a run, I much prefer to throw on an extra layer and go for a run when it's 30 degrees out than be down to a, like, tank top and running shorts and just melting. I feel like the Wicked Witch of the West. So for all of you who are summer weather aficionados, enjoy. I'm glad that there is someone who feels like that, because it is not me. And it's not really even that hot here. I mean, we're not in the hundreds or anything like that, and we don't really have humidity here. We're actually super dry, so I think we're in the like 5 to 10% range. Anyway. Basically from here until late September, when we start getting cooler nights and it cools back down and it feels like fall, I'm on the vampire schedule. Blinds drawn, only active at night, that kind of thing. Anyway, so that's where I am currently in terms of our weather here in northern New Mexico. My husband is flying home today. He will be home for a whole week, which will be fantastic. Really looking forward to that. He's somewhere in the air between Atlanta and Albuquerque as we speak. So let's get started. So this first section is going to be knitting, and you'll excuse me, I'm going to actually write down some timestamps so I remember when things are happening. Knitting. I have a finished object to share with you guys. This is a piece that I have worked up for the Yarn Guys. It is knit in their DK Weight Alpaca Wool Blend, which is Me Too. It is a traditional set of Norwegian color patterns that are all snowflake related. The pattern is called Julutortu, which is a Scandinavian pastry that looks very similar to these type of stars. It's a pinwheel or star snowflake type motif with little jam dolloped in the openings. So this is the small or regular sized version of this. The pattern has two sizes. It's knit in two colors of the DK weight, and really a good starter type color work project, because there's no seams and all the shaping is incorporated into each of the bands to make this capelet shape. I will put a link below to the Ravelry page. You can, of course, knit this in any DK weight yarn. This is a super soft, really warm and scrumptious version. I love it. I think this is a great, like, fall. See, I'm already thinking about fall, you guys. I told you. Fall layering piece. So, yeah, really happy with how that came out. And, yes, it's not exactly the kind of thing that you would wear over a little sundress in the summer, but that's okay. You could knit it now and it could go on the holiday box. I'm just saying. So in other knitting news, I am still working on my Santa Fe collection, the garments. I wanted to say a huge shout out to Jenny and Susan, who are helping me work on either testing or sample knitting for that, or both, as well as Deb. I don't know if Deb watches my podcast, but if you do, Deb, thank you too. I have two pieces are completely finished out of the six. I have two others in progress. A third one will go on the needles this weekend. So feeling pretty good about that. I think we'll be in good shape to get that laid out. My friend Lori up in Canada is going to do layout for me, and she sent me some sample pages yesterday, like a screenshot, just to kind of show me where she was going with it. Love it. I think it's going to look fantastic. It's going to be a really fun fall collection. So stay tuned for more details on that. That will be premiering at Stitches SoCal, I guess is what they're calling it. The one in Pasadena, the new one in November. But we probably will have some takeaway cards for promotional type image things in Stitches Midwest, which is in August in Schaumburg, Illinois. Also, I will put the bug in your ear that if you are somebody who wants to go to Stitches SoCal, I think it's not official yet, but I have had discussions with the Stitches events organizers, and I believe I'm going to be teaching 9 hours worth of classes at Stitches SoCal. There'll be 1 3-hour and 1 6-hour class that'll be divided between 2 days, where you'll have a day to do some stuff with me in the classroom, and then overnight where you can shop and work on your swatching, and then we'll finish up the other half of the class the second day. So stay tuned on that. I hope that I will have some more definitive information for you guys probably by the 1st of June or thereabouts. I think that's what they're shooting for. And then finally, I will put a link below the Filament Spring 2018 issue is going live this weekend. Lots of fun pieces. I will hopefully have those to share with you next time I record, so you guys can see the samples in person. But do check those out. Really fun collection with lots of great details, lace, beads, some really nice wearable layering pieces to move us from slightly warm weather to very warm weather. So I hope you all will look for that. Otherwise, I'm not really doing any kind of personal knitting right now. I am like completely focused on getting the Santa Fe collection done. I may cast on for a pair of just basic socks. Maybe not even basic, maybe just socks. I have some kits from a sock club from literally like 8 years ago that I would like to get knit up that are Lord of the Ring themed. So I may pull one of those out just to have something to work on while my husband's here. Normally in the evenings, I'm here by myself, and so I either watch something on Netflix or I read while I knit. And the piece that I'm working on right now has a lot of colors, and it's very, like, I'm very focused on the chart, so it's not really a great have a glass of wine and relax kind of piece, which is fine when I'm here by myself, but I want to make sure that I have lots of time spent with my husband, so some simpler socks might be the way to go. I may wind the yarn for those this evening. We'll see what I decide to do. Anyway, so that is knitting. Let's move on to spinning. I have been working on one project to kick the month off. This is another deep stash down spin. This is all I have left. I think it's maybe an ounce worth. The roving is from Funky Carolina. It is on Finn wool, which is one of my favorites to spin. It spins like a dream. The colorway is Stewart, John Stewart from The Daily Show, who sadly has retired, but is an alumni of the same institution of higher learning that I went to, College of William and Mary. So I have always enjoyed his very dry humor. I miss him and wish he was still on more places than just occasional guest shots on the Stephen Colbert's Tonight Show. Anyway, this is what I have left. Bobbin one is finished. These are the singles. Will probably be heavy DK or worsted weight by the time it plumps up when I apply it, which I'm hoping to do this weekend. I have the remaining ounce plus on the wheel, so I just have to finish this little bit of the singles, and that one is done. I'm kind of close to my goals in terms of what I wanted to get done this year per month. I need to kick it into gear a little bit, but the Tour de Fleece is coming up. I believe it's the 7th through the 29th of July. We will be having a hosted group thread over in the Ravelry Willy Wonka Fibers group if you're a spinner and want to join us. The tour is always a blast. There'll be the usual fun, like weekly prizes and some things like that. I will have fiber listings up in the store next week, I think it is, the end of next week. Kind of getting ready if you need to stock up on stuff for June to be ready to spin in July. So that's my month. I want to get at least a couple of braids spun, kind of increase my totals to hit my goal of 5 pounds spun this year. That's my goal. So that is where I am in spinning. I do not have anything kind of waiting as my next spin. I'll just pull something out of stash and go from there when I get there. Okay. I think what I'm going to do next is talk about books. So I'm going to stick this in here in the middle. You can watch it first if you're just here for the spinning. If you're here for the knitting, then this can kind of be the last thing you watch. I've done a lot of reading this last couple of weeks. Okay. I suspect that several of these will not be of huge interest, so I'm not going to spend a ton of time on them, but they were ones that fit my challenge themes for the year. So the first book is called Slow Getting Up by Nate Jackson. So I picked this for a book written in the first person. Nate Jackson is an American football player. He played for the Broncos for most of his career. He's retired now. And this is a book about him being in the NFL. He sustained a lot of injuries. He was he was not drafted, but he was originally hired as a wide receiver. And he had a number of injuries, as I guess most people in the NFL do. They wound up switching him to tight end position. He sustained more injuries. Eventually, that was the end of his career. I mean, crazy stuff. Like, he had his hamstring muscle completely detached from the bony structure in the back of his pelvis. I mean, just completely rip off. And he played 2 seasons with the opposite one partially torn. Other things you would expect, I mean, just the physical toll that it takes to be a football player is crazy. This book was okay. It was an interesting book to show some of the behind the scenes of the NFL. The last chapter was really odd. It was kind of surreal almost. I'm not sure I got the point of why he wrote it that way, other than that he was on a lot of painkillers for that last 18 months that he was in the league. So anyway, unless you're somebody who like is really, really into football, and even then, I'm not sure this book has a very wide pool of folks who will want to read it who watch my videos, but there it is. Okay, finished that one. The next book I read was called Mrs. Sherlock Holmes by Brad Rica or Riccia. I'm not sure how he says his last name. As always, I will put all the Goodreads links below so you can find these books if you're so inclined. This was an Edgar Award nominee. The Edgar Award is based on Edgar Allan Poe, so it's things that are about mysteries and suspense and that kind of thing. And this was one of the 2018 nominees, and I thought it was going to be an excellent book. It is based on a real-life woman at the turn of the 19th into the 20th century who was one of the first women to go to law school. She wound up becoming somebody who worked with the police in New York City, tamped down on a lot of sort of worker exploitation rings, wound up solving the mystery of a disappeared young woman from a fairly wealthy New York family, had her own detective agency basically, and really fought for the rights of a lot of immigrants in the United States. And she utilized a lot of methods that Arthur Conan Doyle talks about, you know, incorporates into the Sherlock Holmes stories. This book could have been so good, and it was so not. It was really, really slow. The author started off well, where he ties in Conan Doyle coming to America, and he really sucks you into the story of this young woman's disappearance, and then the book just totally bogs out. It's a real slog to get through. I really wanted more from it. I really wanted to know more about this woman. I think she was probably an amazing person and definitely a force to be reckoned with. This book is just so dry. And hey, you know, I have a history degree. I'm used to reading kind of long, boring, dry history books. This is not even good from those standards. There was not much here to hold my interest. So you'd probably be better off reading the book as kind of a summary and then hitting Wikipedia if you care to find out more information about this woman's life, because this book is just a slog to get through. So really disappointed in that one. I wanted a whole lot more than I got. Okay, next up was a book that I picked for the topic, a book that you think will make you laugh. And the book that I picked is Believe Me, which is the autobiography of the British comedian Eddie Izzard. I like Eddie Izzard's comedy. His Star Wars Cantina sketch and his Stormtroopers Take Your Kid to Work Day sketch are hilarious. I love his dry sense of humor. I love many of his stage skits. So this book is not actually that funny. It is obviously his autobiography, and I have read other autobiographies of comedians or people who are humorous writers or present humor in some way. This book isn't really that. I mean, it's it's the story of his life, which is amazing. He is somebody who's overcome a lot of things that would probably have stopped a lot of normal people in their tracks. He lost his mom when he was six. She died of cancer. He's severely dyslexic. And, he picked a career that's not that easy to break into, especially when you don't have a mentor or know how to break into doing stand-up comedy. So the fact that he's been successful and done amazing things with his life is a credit to him and his strength of will and his willingness to work hard and all of that. So all of that comes through in the book, and it is an interesting informational tale of his life. For instance, why he chose to run 27 marathons in 27 days in South Africa. I guess footnote here, if you don't know who he is, he happens to be a transvestite. When he performs, he often wears women's clothing, which isn't really about, doesn't have anything to do with his comedy. His comedy is completely separate from that. That's just a footnote for something else that he's had to work through and deal with, and the coming out process for him. There are a lot of footnotes. If you decide to read this book, just go into it knowing that there are a lot of footnotes. And I listened to the audiobook, which has even more footnotes, because some of the best kernels of information in the audiobook are where he just goes off on tangents, where he's talking about things like meeting Robin Williams and how that came about, and working in the film industry, and his love of refined sugar. So was this a book that I like laughed out loud at? No. There were little funny pieces here and there, and again, I can appreciate the depth of his character from having read this book, but it's not a humorous autobiography where he's telling jokes or even necessarily telling funny stories. Most of the stories are very bittersweet, and it's more just like a regular, whatever that is, autobiography. So toss that out. Have read that one this week. Next, told you there was a lot of books. This book is called Fear the Drowning Deep. And the author's name is Sarah Marsh, and I read this for the topic of a book that is set on or in or underwater throughout the main part of the book. So it's a young adult book, and I think probably suitable for most teen readers on up. The main character, she and her family live on the Isle of Man, and it's early 20th century. The island in general, their entire industry is basically based on the sea, lots of fishing, nautical type things, and first, the fish seem to have disappeared. Like, none of the fishermen are coming back to the island with good catches. And then young women start disappearing. And the main character is this young woman whose family, she's one of a family of four girls. Their dad's a fisherman. Her mom paints these fantastical pictures of sea creatures, mythical sea creatures that she sees in dreams. And this young woman is apprenticed to the town witch, for lack of a better word. It's not really a book about witchcraft. It's more a book about this sort of small island and this boy that she rescues from the sea. The main character does not like the sea. She's scared of it. She saw her grandfather basically walk off a cliff and drown. And since then, she's been terrified of the sea. So it is about the scary things that live in the sea. It's a little uneven. I think it's the author's first book. She had some really good storylines in it that were a little bit juvenile, I think. beefs with young adult writing is that the heroine in many of them tends to whine a lot, and I don't care for that. So I just want her to grow up and move on, and she does in this instance. And I think there are some redeeming parts to this book, but I would give it like a B minus. It isn't one of my favorite young adult books that I've read. It's an entertaining read, and like I said, I think it would be suitable. There's some scary bits, but not terrifying, and there's no sex and not really a lot of violence particularly. There's one scene, but it's between these mythical sea creatures, this sea serpent that's we come to find is off the sea coast. So yeah, B minus. Good, but not great. Finally this week, I am almost done. You can see I have this much left. This little book called The Wisdom of the Shire, A Short Guide to a Long and Happy Life. This is just a really sweet little book. What the author's done is he's gone through, and I guess I should preface this by saying, if you are not a Lord of the Rings nerd, this book is probably not for you, but let me just say, I am not like the Stephen Colbert where I'm not at his level where I have everything memorized. I've read the books, The Hobbit, as well as the trilogy. I have seen all those movies. So I know the stories well, and I know the characters well, but I'm not somebody who like gets into all of the little teeny tiny minutiae. This book has just some thoughtful essays on why it would be good to live your life as a hobbit. And it's from some very basic things like, taking time to enjoy some of the smaller things in life, like good company, good food, celebrating your birthday, things like that. The benefit of taking a sort of walkabout tour, knowing where you came from, knowing who you are. And each chapter is, maybe 10 pages. And one of the nice things that the author has done is he does include a fair number of footnotes that refer to the things he's talking about. A lot of the old English terms that Tolkien used to create the language that exists in the world he created for The Lord of the Rings. Just things like even the Shire is an Old English term. And then at the end of each chapter, he does a little thing that says, the wisdom of the Shire tells us, and he sort of extrapolates a thing to think about and hold in your mind that the chapter has illustrated. So for instance, this one where he talks about he talks about why the hobbits were well chosen to complete the task of destroying the One Ring. If you have been chosen for a particular challenging task, face it with heart, courage, and wit, and never lose sight of your compassion. So, is this an earth-shattering book? No. But it's sweet, and it's lovely, and it has lots of Lord of the Rings references in it, so I've been enjoying it. I had a friend recommend it to me, and she just thought it would be kind of a nice palate cleanser, and it is that, so that's what I'm reading currently, and almost finished it. So that takes us through books. I'm not sure what I'm going to tackle next to read. I have a couple of ones that I downloaded for this weekend, but we'll see what I feel like. I'm not sure where I want to go with it next. Okay, so let's move on to stitching. I have a bunch of things to share with you guys. The first of which is an FFO. This is my Bowl of Scaries piece, which I finished up. I showed you guys that I was gonna, or told you guys I was gonna tackle this. So it actually only took me 5 days to finish. I think that's right. And I didn't have very much done. I had started the border. I had this tree, and part of this tree, like just that much done. So, hey, monogamania, focus, stitching. It was awesome. So I finished that. This is on 36 count Legacy linen. The colorway is Legacy from Picture This Plus. It is 36 count linen. All the Weeks Dye Works threads that were called for. I backed it with this little ticking that's kind of a dark gray. It's not quite black, but I thought it went really well with the color of the trees. And then the chenille trim came in the kit. So that is done. I think that came out really cute. I can't wait to have this out for the fall. There we go, the fall, and back to the fall celebrations. Have passed the stash along to Bendy Stitchy, Michelle Garrett. And I know she just got that this week, so that is hers to stitch as she chooses. Next up, so since I have been participating in the monogamania work on a project here for the month of May, because I finished that small one, I've gone ahead and been focusing on a stitching shelf. So here is currently where I am. This is the top of, or the edge of page 2. So I have this section right here left to finish to get a page finish. I love this door, but oh my gosh, these brass rivets or whatever they are, the hardware for the exterior of the door, confetti crazy. There's like 4 colors in each of those, and they're of course spread out, so it's not like you're getting a block of anything. This piece has, you know, there'll be one block that'll be like literally out of the 100 stitches, there's like 89 colors. I'm not making that up. But then the next block will only have 4. So in a way, it's kind of hard to get into a rhythm, but in another way, I'm really glad that we have those blocks that only have 4 colors, because if every block was as confetti heavy as some of these, I'm not sure I would have the intestinal fortitude to spend so much time with this. I have been loving working on this piece, and I think it looks amazing. You know, I have oodles and oodles left to do, but I am gonna work till I get a page finish, which today's only the 11th. I'm very confident I can finish this bit this month without any problems. And then I will probably go on and start the next page and just stick with this for the entire month and see how far I get. If you haven't seen it before, here is what the finished piece will look like when it's, let me take it out of the plastic so you can see it. There is what the finished piece will look like when it's done. So you can see I've got, I finished that little green balloony thing, and I'm about there on the door. So that's basically where it's cutting across. And I've just started the upper part of this purple book. Chugging along. I did some calculations for this. I am stitching it 1/1 on 25 count. It's the Magic Grid. It basically is 130. That can't be right. Hang on. I wrote down somewhere, how many stitches each shelf was for vertical, looking at it vertically. I'm gonna find this in here. Hang on. sworn I had this written down. I mean, not that it really matters. It's huge. It's huge. Again, this is the large format PDF. It is not the max color. It is not the super size. It's just that the pages are broken up slightly differently. So I think in the regular version, it actually cuts off at the bottom of the key. And in my version, the pages cut off about there. So there's more pages total. But yeah, so working on page 2 of 96, I believe it is. You know, every stitch makes a difference. Okay, so that really is my plan for the rest of the month. I know that's super boring and not very interesting, but that's what I'm working on, and we'll continue to work on it through the end of the month and see how far I get. I am not burned out on it yet, so that's good, but I do think when I get to the end of the month, you know, I'll have another page finish, and I think at that point then I'm gonna switch to trying to get another project finished in June, and then whatever I have time for, I'll work on the end of the month some other full coverage piece as my monogamous piece. So that is stitching and plans in the world of cross stitching. So next, I just wanted to talk to you guys a little bit about this project. Now, last weekend was a weekend that I get an infusion treatment. I actually get them every 8 weeks, and this is nothing new. I'm like year 10 of this particular drug. So I have a very quiet weekend. It's kind of like knowing that you'll be booked in to have the flu. I run a fever and I take a lot of drugs to keep that tamped down and just generally kind of feel not so great. And I know that my brain is not plugged in very well on this weekend. I have to take a lot of Benadryl to get over the side effects of the infusion. So, you know, I'm in that weird like semi-stoned Benadryl state. So I did not work on this project much this past weekend, but it is on tap for this weekend now that I am back to the land of the living. So I'm working on the chemise. I've got the top piece finished. It will not stay together. Doesn't look like much, I know, but you can see the white on white stripes with the cute little eyelet lace. This overlaps here at the front. Okay, so I'm gonna work on that this weekend. I have the bottom section to put together. I have to work on, there's little pin tucks along here, so I have to do those first. And then the rest of it is actually fairly straightforward. So we're gonna work on those and then attach everything together. So that is where I am on that. I did get the material for the corset. The one I'm making is this one right here. So I went ahead and had them send me the coutil. Coutil is just a very heavy, almost canvas-like feeling, cotton. It does have this really pretty little damask type pattern on it, but it is fairly thick and it holds up really well. You can put it under a fair amount of strain and it does just fine. It's not light and airy, I'll just say that. And then, so that came in the kit I ordered, and as well, it came with all of the, so it's got the lacings, it's got this, let me pull that out so you can see it. It came with the tape. So this will be used to basically make the casings that the boning will go in. So all of the steel boning, each one of those will live inside one of those and be sandwiched in between the exterior coutil and the interior lining. It came with the grommets and the awls. You can pop holes through the fabric. And it comes with a whole bunch of sizes of the steel. So depending on where it is in the corset, the longer ones are for the back, the shorter ones go underneath your armpits. So there's all of those. And then, actually I haven't even opened the busk, so let me do that so you guys can see it. Excuse this, it's gonna be really loud. And then there's the front busk. So. And the pieces that hook together. So while they, while it is helpful to have someone help you fit the corset onto you the first time you wear it so you can tighten the laces, which are in the back, to fit. After that, you can loosen them enough when you take it off that then you can just hook this closed in the front and pull the laces to tighten it a little bit yourself, and then you can actually tie it in the front. You know, there's lots of folks who wore corsets who did not have servants necessarily to help them get dressed. Obviously, if you had servants, it made it that much easier and you could really get a lot of tight cinching down. But if you were just looking at developing the silhouette and the correct shape, you could achieve that on your own and be able to get yourself in and out of the corset without having to have someone help you unlace the whole thing down the back every single time you took it on or off. So I don't know if I will get to starting any of the mock-up on this weekend. I want to look at getting the chemise finished first and having that completely done. And for the corset, what I'm going to do is cut all the pieces out, fit everything together in a muslin, and then try that on. And if I have to adjust anything, which I probably will, I'm short. Distance wise from my armpit to my hip, so I'll probably have to take out a depth length on that. Once that fits well, that muslin, then I will actually cut the real fabric and do the rest of the construction for the structure of the corset at that point. So a long stage process, but that'll be my thing I'm working on. I did have some thoughts on the fabric that I want to use for the exterior. That actually is supposed to be here today, but I did not have it at the time of filming, so I'll show you that next time. I decided to go in a different direction. I was really struggling with trying to match this silk. It would make me feel better to buy fabric for it in person. So I may take it, and at some point when I'm like back on the East Coast in DC, where there's a lot more options for fabric buying, see what I can find then. I did get my swatches from renaissancefabrics.net. One of them might have worked, but I just wasn't in love with it. So instead, because they sent me a coupon, I'm sure to encourage me to buy those particular fabrics that I had asked for samples of. I found two others that I liked that are very true to the period, but I think could get dressed up or down. During that late Victorian period, things that were plaid and Scottish, Balmoral Castle, were really, really popular. So I found a plain green herringbone cotton and a plaid that goes with it, and that I'm going to use for the overskirt and the front piece of the bodice. So it'll be day wear looking, but like I said, I think I can adjust that fairly easily if I wanted to do something more steampunky and sort of Comic-Con feel to it with accessories without it being too overly dressy. So next time I will show you the patterns for those, and I will show you the fabrics for those as well, because they, like I said, they should be here today, which I'm excited about. I think that's it, you guys. 45 minutes. Okay, that wasn't too bad for a combo recording. So hopefully you've been able to just get to the parts you want, or if you are somebody who wanted to listen to the whole thing, hey, here we are at the end. So thanks for sticking with me for 45 minutes plus. Like I said, I am going to try to film about every 2 weeks. I think this will be the Memorial Day weekend, which I'm very excited about. I am going down to Santa Fe the Memorial Day weekend. There is an endurance ride. I am not riding. But one of my favorite people in the world is our equine vet who vetted with us the whole time that we had our horses. And he's going to be vetting the endurance ride that will be down there that weekend. And so I'm going to go down to help him check horses in Friday. And then I'll spend Saturday helping him check the horses through when they come through at the stops. The endurance rides, there are several vet checks depending on what distance you're riding, at least one, sometimes two, plus the beginning vet check and the ending vet check to make sure that the horses are all in great shape. Riders, you can be completely beat up, you're on your own, but the American Endurance Conference really, really stresses having your horse in good shape and fit to continue, and you like to see happy, healthy horses who are having a good time out on the trails. So just having the vet there would make sure that nothing funky happens, or if there is a horse who needs to have a human speak up for it, that's what the vet's there to help do and provide any treatment. You know, sometimes they'll catch their hoof on something or do something stupid and go off trail and get a cut leg or whatever, but it doesn't happen very often, and most people take excellent care of their horses, which is great. This just is another set of eyes on them, so we all know that the horses are being well taken care of. So anyway, that will be my plan, and so I'll have that to talk about and report on next time I talk to you guys. I'll probably record either Sunday or Monday of that Memorial Day weekend here in the U.S. So until then, I hope you all are doing great wherever you are in the world, and I'm really enjoying watching all of the Stitchmania progress videos and vlogs and all of that. There's some amazing projects out there. So I'm living vicariously through all of you who are participating in Mania this year. You guys take care. I will talk to you in a couple of weeks. Happy stitching, happy knitting, happy crafting. Bye.